our primary objective is to go to 80, up to 120 knots. But once we've gotten out on the wing, it's going to be up to the pilots. This test plan, it's a human factors evaluation. It's making sure that there's nothing that's unexpected.
All of this collective work over the past 6.5 years has gotten us to this.
All closed out. We're all good to go.
We just accomplished the first inhabited transition of a vectored lift eVTOL, which means we've taken an inhabited aircraft from the hover, accelerated out onto the wing as an airplane. And that's a first for the eVTOL industry. So that's really, really exciting for us.
It felt amazing. It's all what we look forward to. We just never had the seat of the pants cubes. Now we do. Accelerations were great to get to our cruise speed of 100 knots, and then the flight dynamics and flying quality through wonderful.
We got a winner.
Welcome to the Deep Dive. Today, we're really digging into something that feels like it's leaped straight out of science fiction. Flying cars, air taxis.
Yeah.
They're not just concepts anymore, are they? It seems like they're becoming, well, real, astonishingly fast. So our mission today is to cut through the hype around electric vertical takeoff and landing aircraft EV aerials and see what's actually happening on the ground, in the air. We'll focus a lot on one key player, Joby Aviation, but connect it all back to the bigger picture for you. Because when you look at everything happening, I mean, the money flowing in, the tech leaps, and crucially, the government stepping up, it really feels like this whole industry is hitting a tipping point. We're definitely past just talking about it.
Exactly. And that's the key, right? We're moving past the what if
yeah.
and looking at hard data, real numbers. We're talking market valuations, big deals, actual regulatory steps. This isn't just dreaming anymore. It's about tracking tangible progress.
Okay, so let's start there with JOBY Aviation. The numbers are pretty eye-opening. Ticker's JOBY on the NYSE. Stock's around, what, $8.85 lately, which puts their market cap at roughly $7.44 billion. Now, I know what you're thinking. That's huge for a company that isn't even bringing in revenue yet.
It is huge. And yeah, they're pre-revenue. They reported a net loss, $246 million for Q4 2024. And the forecast for Q1 25 earnings per share was -2, like $92.19. That's pretty standard for these kinds of deep tech growth companies, though. But here's the flip side. Look at their balance sheet. They finished Q1 this year with $813 million in cash and short-term investments. That's a solid cushion.
A very solid cushion. And that's before you even mention the Toyota money, right?
Right. Toyota just put in another strategic $500 million commitment. That brings Toyota's total investment to over $1.1 billion. That's not just cash. That's a massive vote of confidence from a global manufacturing powerhouse. It signals belief in their ability to actually produce these things at scale.
That financial muscle is critical. And it sort of sets the stage for this other huge development just from June 3rd, 2025. Joby signed an MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding, with Abdul Latif Jamil, ALJ. Now, ALJ, they're a big deal, right? An 80-year-old diversified business network. What's really going on with this partnership? Is it just selling planes?
Oh, it's much, much more than just selling planes. ALJ has incredibly deep roots and operational know-how in Saudi Arabia and the wider Middle East. This partnership kind of builds on that renewed economic link between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia. And the potential scale is enormous. We're looking at potentially up to 200 Joby aircraft, plus all the related services. The value could be around $1 billion over the next few years.
$1 billion, wow.
Yeah, but like I said, it's not just the sale. The MOU covers distribution, actually setting up local air taxi services, handling all the maintenance, repair, overhaul the MRO stuff, and even pilot training. It's basically handing ALJ the keys to build the entire Joby ecosystem in the region.
And this fits right into Saudi Arabia's Vision 2030 plan, doesn't it? Modernizing, diversifying their economy, creating jobs.
Perfectly. It's a major step for their goals around new mobility on demand, sustainable transport. You heard what Joby's CEO, Jobin Bevert, said, bringing America's leadership in electric air mobility to the world. And Hassan Jamil from ALJ echoed that, talking about this new era of mobility and calling eVTOL an exciting and important component.
So it really feels like a template for how this could roll out globally.
I think so. It shows Joby's smart, multi-pronged strategy. Yeah. They've got these direct sales, like ALJ. Then they plan to own and operate services themselves, probably starting in the U.S. And they also have partnerships for other markets, like we know about Japan and that recent U.K. deal with Virgin Atlantic they announced back in March.
Right, the Virgin Atlantic deal, announced March 16th, aiming for U.K. air taxi services. And it's not just commercial, they're deepening ties with the U.S. Air Force, too, committing to deliver 2 aircraft to MacDill Air Force Base this year in 2025. That adds a whole defense revenue stream. They already sent their 2nd plane to Edwards Air Force Base back in February.
Yeah, the military angle is definitely important. It provides early operational experience and revenue.
And then there's Dubai, still planning first passenger flights there in 2026.
That's the plan. Aircraft delivery to Dubai is actually slated for mid-2025, so very soon. They are moving fast.
Okay, so the business side is buzzing. Let's pivot to the actual aircraft. For people maybe still picturing, you know, the Jetsons, what are we actually talking about here?
Huh. Yeah, not quite the Jetsons car. Yeah. Joby's aircraft is piloted, fully electric. It's designed for a pilot plus 4 passengers. Key things are speed up to 200 miles per hour and efficiency. It gives you that high speed travel, but way, way quieter than a helicopter. And critically, 0 operating emissions. That's huge for urban environments.
Quiet and clean. That's a big selling point. So how far along are they with actually building and flying these things?
That's where it gets really tangible. They're actively producing manned pre-production aircraft right now.
Yeah.
The expectation is they'll roll out their very first certification aircraft, like the one that goes through all the formal FAA hoops, very soon. But they haven't been sitting idle. They've racked up thousands of flight hours already on their demonstrators and these pre-production models. They've opened the entire piloted flight envelope.
8, 9, airborne, see 100 knots.
Set it to speed, called it, easing the height rate, holding 2.5.
Perfect.
Okay, open the flight envelope. What does that mean in plain terms?
It means they've pushed the aircraft through its full range of operations, different speeds, altitudes, maneuvers. They've tested its limits to prove it can handle everything it's designed to do safely with a pilot on board. And what's really smart, strategy-wise, they're dry running a lot of the official certification tests on these pre-production planes.
Dry running, like practicing for the real test.
Exactly. Find the problems now, fix them now, before the clock starts ticking on the formal FAA testing. It could potentially shorten that whole final certification phase quite a bit. And back in April, April 29th, they hit what they called a testing landmark, achieving routine pilot onboard flights. That's a big confidence builder towards FAA testing.
Okay, so testing is moving along, but you mentioned certification, the FAA. That sounds like the big hurdle.
Yeah.
You said eVTOLs are a whole new type of aircraft for the FAA, power lift. That sounds complicated.
It is complicated. And yeah, that's where it gets really interesting, because there's no existing blueprint for certifying a power lift aircraft. It takes off and lands like a helicopter, but flies efficiently like a plane. So Joby and the FAA are kind of writing the rulebook together as they go. It's uncharted territory.
So that Q1 2025 record certification progress they mentioned, that's about navigating this new process.
Precisely. It's about agreeing on the means of compliance, submitting the certification plans, getting sections approved. It's painstaking work. But all those flight hours, those dry runs we talked about, they should help speed up the formal part, the type inspection authorization or TIA, flight testing, and getting that final certification signed off.
Any sense of a timeline for that final certification?
Well, projections are always tricky, but SMG Consulting, they're specialists in this area, put out a note just recently, June 9th. They forecast Joby's S4 aircraft getting its type certification by Q1 2027, then operational certification by Q3 2027, and actually starting commercial service entry into service or EIS, by Q4 2027.
Q4 2027. That's not that far away, really.
It's ambitious. But if they hit it, that projection puts Joby potentially ahead of the other big U.S. players like Archer and Beta Technologies for getting into service. That's a massive potential advantage.
Okay, so Joby's pushing hard on its own. But then, just a few days ago, June 6th, the White House steps in. This new executive order, unleashing American drone dominance. How much does something like that actually help a company like Joby that's already deep in the process?
That's a great question. Does it really move the needle? I think it does, significantly. It's more than just cheerleading. This order signals a fundamental shift from the government. Its goals are broad: speed up safe commercial drone use, integrate them fully into national airspace, boost U.S. manufacturing, increase exports, and crucially for our conversation, it specifically calls out eVTOLs for cargo and passenger transport.
So it acknowledges eVTOLs are part of this drone dominance push?
Explicitly. But the real kicker is the speed it demands from the FAA. This isn't gentle encouragement. It's setting hard deadlines, like proposing rules for routine beyond visual line of sight BVLOS flights within 30 days, using AI to speed up waiver reviews within 120 days, publishing an updated integration roadmap in 240 days. That's forcing the pace in a way we haven't seen before. It's shifting the FAA from cautious gatekeepers to, well, maybe more of an active enabler.
Okay, tight deadlines for the FAA. But how does that translate directly to getting Joby's passenger eVTOLs in the air faster?
Through a brand new program established by the order, the eVTOL Integration Pilot Program, or EIPP. Think of it as a focus accelerator for passenger and heavy cargo eVTOLs. It builds on an existing drone program called Beyond. The FAA has 90 days to ask state, local, and tribal governments for project proposals. Then, within 180 days, they have to pick at least 5 pilot projects.
5 pilot projects across the country. What kind?
They need to use U.S.-based eVTOL tech, so good news for Joby, Archer, Beta. And they want diversity. Advanced air mobility, like air taxis, medical uses, cargo, maybe connecting rural areas. These projects will run for about 3 years once they start flying, generating real-world data to shape future rules and, frankly, to show U.S. leadership. It's direct government backing for operational trials.
And it sounds like there's a bigger economic and security play here, too.
Definitely. The order emphasizes strengthening the U.S. drone industrial base. You know, build them here, secure the supply chains, don't rely on potential adversaries, plus promoting exports of U.S. tech and even getting drones into military use faster. It's looking at this whole sector as strategically vital for the U.S.
Okay, so pulling it all together, it really feels like the pieces are aligning. Significant private money, like from Toyota and ALJ. Real manufacturing and testing progress from Joby. And now, this very clear, very urgent push from the government to clear the regulatory path and run pilot programs. Flying cars and taxis, they're really happening.
They really are. And connecting it to the bigger picture, for everyone listening, this isn't just cool tech. It's about fundamentally changing how we get around, how goods move. You could reshape cities, create whole new industries, new jobs. Now, look, the challenges are still real. Burning through cash before revenue ramps up, navigating those final FAA hurdles. That's tough for all these companies. But the momentum, particularly for a leader like Joby, feels pretty undeniable right now. We're watching a new type of mobility being born.
So just think about that for a moment. Your daily commute. Could it really involve hopping in an electric air taxi in, say, 5 or 10 years? Hmm. How might our cities, even remote areas, change when you add this quiet, clean, fast layer of transportation on top? It's not just faster travel, it's potentially rethinking how we live and work. It's fascinating stuff. And you can bet, as this evolves so quickly, we'll be back with another deep dive as soon as there's major news to break down.